First of all, let me say thank you. You can back off some of that reverb there. My name's Dave Clark. I'm the morning anchor man for KTVU Channel 2 here in the Bay Area. Thank you. And I'm glad to meet you too. Thank you for being here for one of the most special events in the Bay Area today. There's no place else to be but right here at Merritt College for the Barbara Lee and Elihu Harris lecture series, and you make it extra special having you here. I'm so glad to be here with you, and there are so many special people to acknowledge, which I will momentarily, but you know the world that we live in right now, and how this week has already been, how this day, this afternoon has been. There's no place else to be but to be able to see and listen to Congresswoman Barbara Lee and Congressman James Clyburn. You know, this is normally my bedtime. No. I wanted to be here to see them. I want to acknowledge some special people first, so just bear with me. I'm going to drive this bus. We're going to get there on time, so don't worry. But I want to acknowledge some very special people. I want to begin by acknowledging the Honorable Elsa Ortiz, the board director of AC Transit. Elsa, right there. Thank you, Elsa. I want to acknowledge Peralta College District Trustee Linda Handy. Peralta College District Trustee Meredith Brown. Peralta College District Trustee, my golfing hero, Bill Riley. Brandon Barranco, representing Assemblyman Tony Thurman. Brandon, where are you? Thank you. Judge Gordon Barranco. Judge? Thank you. And Angelique Keys, representing Oakland Mayor Libby Schaff. Angelique. I don't want to leave anybody out, but I want to make sure that I acknowledge them and welcome you and thank you for being here. Now, our sponsors, the sponsors of the lecture series, you know they're important. And we're going to take time to acknowledge them. The major sponsor, Gilead Science. They are the major sponsor. They may not have a representative here, but we want to acknowledge them. The contributing sponsors, Cisco, represented tonight by Madison Gunter. Madison, right here. Good to see you, Mr. Gunter, my friend. The East Bay Regional Park District, represented tonight by Assistant Manager Carol Johnson. Carol? The Downtown Oakland Marriott Hotel. You know it well. The Institute for Community Leadership, represented tonight by Dr. Nyla Rosen. Pandora, represented tonight by Adan Fadoa. The Coliseum Lexus Company, represented tonight by Mr. Ed Fitzpatrick. Ed, where are you? Our supporters tonight, California Waste Solutions. We thank you and acknowledge you. Yeah. Safeway. Thank you, Safeway. And one of my dear friends, who's one of the best known people in the Bay Area, and he also has a new book. I'm just going to plug it. My dear friend, attorney, community leader, mentor, supporter, just a great man, Mr. Bob Harris. You, Yeah, I love Bob Harris, yeah. Councilwoman Lynette, how are you? Just walked in. Lynette McElhaney Gibson, good to see you. Okay, there you go. It is my pleasure right now, and I have to say this real quick. I don't get a chance to come on this campus often. I love this campus. It is beautiful. The view, I think I wasted my camera taking the view of the sun. It is spectacular. It is my pleasure now to introduce and bring up on stage the president of Merritt College, Dr. Marie Elaine Burns.
Good evening. Don't you all look so beautiful? I love when this place is full with our community. On behalf of Merritt College and the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center, welcome to our wonderful campus. We are so glad to have you. And welcome to the Barbie Lee and Elihu Harris Lecture Series. This evening featuring the Honorable James Clyburn, U.S. Representative and South Carolina's 6th District. The Barbara Lee and Elihu Harris Lecture Series was created by the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center in partnership with Merritt College to promote the vision, leadership, and accomplishments of Congresswoman Barbara Lee and former California State Assemblyman, Oakland Mayor, and Peralta Community College District Chancellor, Elihu Harris. It offers an ample exchange of ideas to help inspire and move forward new leadership and servantship. The lectures have featured civil rights leaders who have worked closely with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., along with others who with him continue to do the work tirelessly for social justice. And we know that today we need this more than ever. This is so timely, given the state of affairs of our country, and given when so many young people are unaware of Dr. King, his accomplishments, and the accomplishments of the civil rights movement. As a matter of fact, there's many people, not just young people, who aren't aware and no longer remember, honor, or celebrate what has those who have gone before that made it possible for all of us to be in this room tonight, for me to be a president of a community college, and more. While many colleges have in recent years committed to equity and social justice, Merritt College is extremely proud of its long and rich legacy of activism, social change, and social justice. As we know, the Black Panther Party was born here and has left this legacy for us to remember. So given all of that, we are so proud to partner with the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center to bring to you series such as these lectures. Thank you so much, and again, welcome.
Let's give Dr. Burns another round of applause. Thank you. I also want to acknowledge Peralta College District Trustee Karen Weinstein. Karen? You know, I don't do this often, but this is such a great crowd. Yeah, I have to take your picture. No, I do. So look, right now. Okay. You thought I was kidding, didn't you? No, I wasn't kidding. Excuse me. This will take a minute. Ready? Anybody else? Got you. No. The congresswoman is going to say, okay, don't make me come up there. One of the real pleasures of being here is just meeting so many nice people, so many good people. The spirit, Meredith and I were talking about the positivity that's here. And a lot of it that I felt when I came here, I felt before I walked in because it came from the man I'm about to introduce. Dr. Roy Wilson, the director of the MLK Freedom Center, a class act. Dr. Wilson, please come on.
Good evening. Congressman Clyburn, welcome to the Barbara Lee and Elihu Harris Lecture Series. We're honored by your presence, Congresswoman Barbara Lee. Thanks for everything you do, not only for your constituents, but for all America and, frankly, the world. Mr. Elihu Harris, thanks for what you've done for California, for the city of Oakland, and for the Peralta Community Colleges. You have a legacy that you've constructed, and the Freedom Center is honored that you have contributed some of your time in retirement. I know you're not retired, as the board chair of the Freedom Center. Thank you so much.
Amen.
To all of our trustees at the Peralta Community College District, we're profoundly honored by the partnership that we have, and it's a wonderful relationship to have a partnership. Peralta is a supporter of the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center, and we are proudly housed at Merritt College. Thank you very much. A shout out to the board of directors. I just mentioned that Mr. Harris, Elihu Harris, is our chair. Our vice chair is Sandra Andrews. Our secretary, Mr. Royal Roberts. And the directors, Alton Jelks, Carol Johnson, Michael Leidy, Dr. William Riley, and myself. I think that's important because the young people are going to address part of this, but we have an incredibly huge staff that gets a lot done. And they would say snaps, but our Director of External Affairs, Dr. Karen Bolke, please give her a hand. Jana Fisher, our accountant. Myra Perez and Kay Yamamoto are educational service directors. That's the group that gets a lot done. Thank you very much. Give them a hand. And the students of the Freedom Center, they're all wearing Stay Woke buttons tonight. So if you see one of those, that's a Freedom Center student. And there's other ways to tell about their poise and their seriousness and their dedication to revolution and to fighting white supremacy and racism. So they're wonderful. Speak with them. They also organize the Barbara Lee and Elihu Harris Lecture Series, and they organize a civic engagement campaign. We're on our second year. It's called To Us, You Matter, Vote. And they, what they go out to community organizations and even homes and senior centers and talk about voter responsibility, voter suppression, and the absolute necessity that a democracy needs all of us. And the students propel that; they're the engine to it. Now, America is truly locked in a fierce struggle between the forces of greed and hate and those of people power and democracy. I call it cruel, and perhaps the root of all cruelty, to know what happens but not recognize the fact. We appeal to a voice, that important region in all of us who talk, though we could fool each other, we should consider, lest the march of our mutual lives gets lost in the dark. For it is important that awake people be awake, or a breaking line may discourage them back to sleep. The signals we give, yes or no, or maybe, should be clear. The darkness around us is deep. Thank you.
Dr. Roy Wilson, well said. We appreciate that. There is so much we will do tonight. I get to bring up a wonderful lady who was standing in for the chancellor, Joelle Laguerre, who had a personal emergency and could not be here. But standing in for him is Peralta District College trustee Meredith Brown. And let me just tell you a little bit about Ms. Brown. She's a law partner with the firm of Atkinson, Andelson, Lawyer, Rude, and Romo, with more than 25 years of experience representing public agencies and private institutions. She gives advice on both private and public issues. She's defended private clients in land use nuisance and California Environmental Quality Act claims. Right now, she's a member of the board of trustees for Peralta Colleges, the four colleges. She's served as a legal counsel for many a public agency, board hearings and meetings and court proceedings and administrative hearings. She's well-versed in the Brown Act, the compliance issues, and she provides training to educational institutions on Title IX and the training on DACA. She knows her stuff. I can go on and on. I need a calculator to add up all the things that she brings to the table. But would you please welcome Meredith Brown.
It's wonderful to be here. We were here, this room was packed an hour early, so I know for a fact that the revolution is on time and everybody's ready. It's just so wonderful to be here. You know, I was planning to come, but I was in my office, of course. You know, I tell the chancellor when I have to go to work that I got to meet my mule. So I was there with my mule, and, you know, the phone rings, and I'm at my desk, and Roy Wilson says, Meredith, are you coming? I'm like, yeah, I'm coming. He says, well, Joelle can't be here. Now, Joelle Laguerre is one of the most gracious people I've ever met, so I'm going to do my utmost to stand in for him. But, you know, the thing I'm supposed to talk about is reflections. And, you know, you guys are just so committed and so beautiful and so positive, but my reflection is just that it's going to be okay. You know, because when I go to bed at night, my husband will say, why are you tossing and turning? And I say, because, you know, your zip code depends on how good your education is. And because the color of your skin determines how long you're going to live, and whether or not you'll get health care, and whether or not you can even make it home because of the violence in your community. And so it's very difficult sometimes to be civil. You know, James Baldwin said, the Negro wears two faces, and one is just rage. And so it's very difficult sometimes to reflect, but I know we're going to be okay. Because I see people that have been at this struggle for a long time, and I know from my family, growing up in Texas, what is that, uniquely Southern, proudly Black, that you just keep going. It's not going to be easy. Easy has never been on the menu, but you just keep going. And when I look at this room and I see the people that are here and I see all ages and all races and all the people, I know it's going to be okay because you're here. You know, I see my friend Mike Moy. I'm not going to tell you how long Mike's been practicing law. I've been practicing law for a while. But I see my friend who's working with Alameda Health Systems, you know, and I see, you know, I see lawyers that are committed to social justice, and I see people that are committed to healthy environments, and I see my neighbors who are lawyers and judges and people that are committed to making this world a better place. And I said, it's going to be okay, because you guys, we are not going to give up. That is my reflection. We will keep going, and we will keep going until there is that dream. Until that becomes a reality. So that's my reflection. You guys are beautiful.
Meredith Brown, thank you for those words. Oh, I have a quick word for you. Do you have a Lexus? There's a Lexus of Marin car, a license plate number NX300H. You left your lights on. Does that ring a bell? Now, I'll go get it, but so don't say no one told you. It's a Lexus of Marin, NX300H. The lights are on. Hopefully, the battery will be on later, too. Okay. We're going to keep moving on. One of the thrills, and our great speakers will be here momentarily. One of the privileges for me that I really enjoyed being here tonight was meeting the students. Incredibly classy, gracious students. You know, if I didn't say that, the words would kick my teeth out. I had to say that. They're very impressive. I'm going to bring up some of the students now from the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center. The students are Randy Lauderdale, Charlotte Potts, and David Gaines. Please come on stage.
Good evening. My name is Randy, and I'm 15 years old. If you want to build muscles, lift weights. To get stronger and stronger, make a habit of daily exercise. Today, we need to build up our organizing strength. To do this, we must organize daily. When we have strong organizing muscles, we are able to overcome obstacles and difficulties. We are able to transform pain into a propelling force. Each of us bears the weight of historical traumas. Of slavery, white supremacy, and colonization. Each of us confronts the burden of our personal pain. Today, around the world, we are experiencing an intentional and strategic wave of fascism. We are confronted by the systems of hatred and violence, which include efforts to disunify and distract us. It's time for us to match and exceed the forces of hatred with the strength of organization, preparation, and resilience. Dr. King calls on us to change ourselves. He challenges us to develop the mind of a serpent and the heart of a dove. We must be tough-minded and tender-hearted enough to overcome the confusion and the smoke screens. The strength to take on more than our individual capacity comes about when we build interracial, intergenerational, international teams of people willing to be unified. Organize! 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 Together, we are better!
Good evening, everyone. My name is Charlotte. I'm 15 years old, and I'd like to begin my comments by giving thanks to the staff of the Martin Luther King Jr. Freedom Center. Thank you to Ms. Jana Jordan Fisher, Kay Yamamoto, Myra Perez, Dr. Karen Bulkey, and our executive director, Dr. Roy Wilson. Looking at the world, it can be easy to have a pessimistic view. However, Dr. King tells us that the moral arc of the universe is long but bends towards justice. Courage is an inner resolution to go forward with our purpose in spite of obstacles or frightening situations. Some of us are told that we're cowards or that we are meaningless. But this is a lie. No one can take away our courage except us. And no one can give us courage except for us. In the words of Dr. King, everyone can be great because anyone can serve. Countries in Africa, like Kenya or Zimbabwe, countries in Latin America, like Haiti or El Salvador. These are the countries we see daily on the products that we consume. And though we all depend on them, the current administration, in vile and vulgar ways, attack the dignity of our brothers and sisters of these countries. The web of connectivity to our fellow humans cannot be avoided. People are being pushed out of jobs, pushed out of housing, pushed out of life itself because rich white supremacists want to own the world. Stay woke. Wake up our families. Stay woke. Wake up our friends. We cannot achieve the end that we're working for unless we all wake up and join the March for Freedom. Let's stay woke. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlotte and Randy.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to resume again. Oh, I know you're awake. I want to acknowledge a couple of people real quick. Judge Noel Weiss of the Superior Court of California, County of Alameda. Judge Weiss, where are you? Right here. Very nice. I'm glad you're here, Judge. I know there are others. I saw two prominent pastors here. Pastor Webster, good to see you. And Pastor Taylor, good to see you as well. And one of the giants of healthcare, Delvecchio Finley of Alameda Health Systems, right up front here. My brother. When I talk about giants, this man's one of them. You know, I smile every time I see him, even if he doesn't like me. No, he does. I have so much respect and fondness for former Mayor Elihu Harris that it's a pleasure to bring him on stage. Would you please welcome Elihu Harris?
Now, I want to show you, I put God first. I want to introduce my pastor, Anthony Jenkins. Pastor Jenkins, Staff, Taylor Methodist Church in West Oakland. And then I want to take a special recognition, although he's spoken and been acknowledged. You know, most people you see on TV, you only see him on TV. Dave Clark, you see in the community, because he's part of the community. And I watch him every morning. Because first of all, you don't want to go out in Oakland until you know what's happening. Yeah. 50 years ago, Martin Luther King was assassinated. And you wonder, what would Martin Luther King find if he were in America, in this world, or in Oakland today? He wrote a book called Chaos or Community, Where Do We Go From Here? Well, we know where we've come over the last 50 years. And today, we've gotten more chaos and gotten farther away from a sense of community. Today, you know, we are practicing and living in a secular world that is close to what you find in Revelations in the Bible. We got a secular Armageddon going on in America. This is about as close to hell as I want to get. What Donald Trump has done is very important, however, because he tore a scab away from an open wound. And now what we suspected is visible. The reality of economic oppression and racism, overt racism, is more apparent than it's been in the last 50 years. Racism has been hiding under a rock. Donald Trump exposed it. So those of you who thought you were living the American dream, you've been living a nightmare. What Barbara Lee has said to us means more than just waking up in the morning. It means not going to sleep at night. Stay woke is what we have to do if we're going to overcome the nightmare that we're in. You know what the biggest threat to democracy is? It's not Donald Trump. It's ignorance. Ignorant voters, ignorant people are the biggest threat to democracy. And Donald Trump represents that level of ignorance in this country. When people could listen to Donald Trump's State of the Union, and even 42% of them can say they approve of what he's doing in this country, there's reason to be scared. You know, I'm telling you, 58% is not enough in this world. Because we're seeing people who are shopping at Walmart saying they agree with Donald Trump on international trade when all the stuff at Walmart coming from China. When people in America say they want a better job and more money, and they support the man that doesn't support minimum wage, that's ignorance. When you see people don't have affordable housing, support someone that wants to take away Section 8 in cities, that's ignorance. We are seeing poor people in this country, particularly in the South and the Midwest, supporting a maniac who is trying to take away their rights, take away their freedom, and give them some false sense by framing the issues in terms they understand that he's doing something for them. And I had a conversation with Congressman Clyburn. We, particularly those of us who are Democrats, and I'm giving this a secular audience and a nonpartisan audience, we've got to frame the issues as well. We have got to communicate to those people. Those kids who step on the stage, they go door to door. They talk to their neighbors. They talk to their schoolmates. Do we talk to each other? Do we begin to let each other know we have a responsibility, not only to those young people, but to our neighbors, to poor people in the South and people around the world who are suffering because this country no longer represents what it said it represented when it established the American dream and the words on the Statue of Liberty. Give us your tired, your sick, and your poor. We got a president that says, we don't want those S-holes in Haiti in our country. We want more white folks from Norway. Because they look like me. No, they don't, because they're white and you're red. We have these lectures, and we're glad you're here because you're part of the choir. When the choir gets out of church, it needs to go and be evangelist. You know, you don't just preach your Christianity in church. If you don't preach it in the world, that means people who need to hear are not getting the message. So today, we have invited one of the most dynamic members of Congress. We are here with two of the best representatives of what democracy is all about. So when you hear their message, don't only take it to heart, take it to the street.
I'm done now. I'll go home. Elihu Harris is always worth listening to. Thank you, Elihu Harris. He's one half of this lecture series. The other half is just as dynamic. One of the most incredible ladies. Now, I'll tell you about her in just a moment. I want to acknowledge, though, that Pastor J. Alfred Smith, Jr. of Allen Temple is here as well. Pastor? There you are. Good to see you. Congresswoman Barbara Lee is tough, is smart, is consistent, and knows her stuff. She is an incredible lady, and I know you know more than I could possibly know. But it's always good to see her and know that she's there. Even though the situation is tough, a warrior is there. Would you please welcome the other half of the lecture series, Congresswoman Barbara Lee.
And let me say how good it is to be home, I tell you. And I have to start by power to the people, because you know where we are, in Oakland, in the Huey Newton Bobby Seale Room. Elihu, Thank you very much, boy. You are a revolutionary now. I've known Elihu since I was a student at Mills College and a community worker with the Black Panther Party. And so I just want to thank you for your unwavering dedication to this community and to our young people. Thank you again, Elihu. Give Elihu a round of applause. Dave, thank you for that kind introduction. And thank you for doing this for us tonight. You're doing the heavy lifting, and really, we do appreciate it. Tell Dave how much you love him, and thank you. And to Dr. Marie Lane Burns, our president, thank you so much for your continued leadership and ensuring that this historic institution is really equipping our students with the skills and the information needed to fulfill their dreams. So thank you again very much for bringing us together. And of course, to all of our trustees with the Peralta, Board of Trustees with Peralta, I want to thank you all so much for being consistent and helping out and really bringing our young people to Washington, D.C. every year. And I mean, they do such a job with these students. So thank you guys very much. It really makes me very proud. And to Bob Harris and to the Board of Directors of the Freedom Center, and of course to Roy and Karen, we couldn't do any of this without you. And I think our young people up here, you heard them. You know what we're doing with them, and it's because of Roy and Karen and our board, and Elihu, that these young people have a future, and they're the leaders of the future. They're going to secure the future for us, and so we have to thank them and thank you for making sure they have this opportunity and this pathway. These students are phenomenal, first of all. We founded the center in the mid-90s, and each year I'm very honored to have several of them, probably five or six, join me on the Congressional Civil Rights Pilgrimage. And in a few weeks, of course, we'll travel to Memphis, Tennessee to commemorate the 50th anniversary of Dr. King's assassination. Then we'll travel, and they do this with me every year, we travel to Birmingham, Alabama, Selma, Montgomery, to visit the 16th Street Baptist Church to meet all of our foot soldiers and heroes and sheroes of the civil rights movement. And of course, they march with us across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma. They continue to represent Oakland and my congressional district in a way that I know you are very proud. And so I just want to thank all of you for being here tonight, because you're giving these young people the inspiration and the motivation and the encouragement to do what they're doing. And so you all should really be proud of what you're doing with these lecture series and with our young people here in Oakland. And they represent us all very well. So thank you all very much. And you know, this provides our young people a framework to really never forget their social consciousness as they work to realize their dreams. I am so honored this series to really be able to bring some of the greatest civil rights leaders, human rights leaders, people who inspire and promote social change to my district. And these people I have the honor and privilege to work with each and every day. And so tonight I am extremely excited to have my colleague and my friend here to put this into perspective. Now let me tell you a little bit about Representative Clyburn. He's been an activist since a very young age. He was elected president of the NAACP youth chapter at the age of 12. 12 years old. He organized marches as a student leader during his South Carolina State College days. And he actually met his beautiful, wonderful wife, Emily, in jail following a student demonstration. Now, how real can you get? Jim began his career as a public school, mind you, public school teacher. All right, public school. And went on to work for the state of South Carolina as the Human Affairs Commissioner under four separate governors from both parties. Jim was elected to Congress in 1993 And he is the third ranking Democrat in the House and has really been a very strong and robust advocate in moving our Democratic agenda forward. Now, Jim represents South Carolina's 6th congressional district, and he's been a strong voice, and he was here kicking off our environmental justice movement within the House. And he's been a strong advocate to protect our environment, to improve our education system, and the fight to ensure that all Americans have access to quality, affordable health care. Jim led the charge to expand funding and the numbers of community health centers in the Affordable Care Act, and we never would have had that had not been for Jim Clyburn. And I have the honor to visit Jim's district quite frequently, and I tell you, he's from Gullah Geechee land, which is a beautiful part of the country, which reflects our African culture and our African language and our African spirit in America, which Jim Clyburn so embodies. Jim knows firsthand the challenges we are experiencing as the racial income gap widens and communities of color fall deeper into poverty. He's on the front line in the fight for justice, and he's well positioned to speak not only to our issues in the Congress, which he has been doing, and now with Donald Trump and Speaker Ryan, I mean, Jim's voice is even more important now because he is pushing the envelope with this administration. For us. Because he knows that if we're to protect our hard-fought progress, our voices must be heard at the ballot box. And if we're to defeat any effort to roll back the clock, we must elect leaders who share our values and who want to move forward to make this country live up to its creed of liberty and justice for all. So tonight, I ask you to open your minds to hear his words of wisdom. He is a very wise and smart man, the son of a preacher. He is an AME. He's an AME. He's a Kappa. No? Omega. Bob's a Kappa. Omega. Excuse me. Okay, Bob. Okay. He's an Omega. Bob's a Kappa. Okay. And he also really has dedicated his life to addressing the real problems and creating change in our communities. But also, I got to just tell you, Jim is very, very cool. Now, and I'm going to tell you this story as I close and bring him up. I walked into one of our leadership meetings one day, and Jim and I were the only African Americans in there. And I walk in with my stay woke button on, right? Everybody's kind of like, what is this? No one would say, like, what does this mean? What is it? But Jim felt the vibes. He knew what was going on. Everybody, all these people kind of looking at each other. So finally, Leader Pelosi said, what is stay woke? And I'm getting ready to say something. Jim says, it means stay awake in Gullah Geechee. And we hadn't even talked before that. So Jim, come on up. I wanted to present to you our stay woke button. Our Omega brother. And you know I got a pin you on this one.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Barbara, for giving me my 10th or 12th stay woke button. Thank you so much for your friendship. All of you who look in on our proceedings on C-SPAN, et cetera, you know that we in the Congress often refer to each other as my good friend, and most times we don't mean it. But I do mean it when I call Barbara Lee my good friend. She is absolutely one of the best friends that I have in the Congress. I love her to death. So much of what I do starts here in Oakland. When I started out on my environmental justice stuff, I came to Oakland. We started out our work to try to renew or reinstate the effectiveness of the Voting Rights Act. I came to Oakland. And it's because Barbara Lee has such a great way of helping me get focused. And I thank her so much for that. And I thank her friends, Karen, Roy, for your hospitality. You've absolutely been great and gracious. And I thank you so much for making me feel so much at home here. And of course, thank you so much for today's weather. Today's weather, it was a little southern. And I really feel at home. Elihu, it's always good to be with you. Thank you for getting out of Barbara's way so she could start her journey that has brought her to Washington, and she really is the conscience of the Congressional Black Caucus. Thank you. I want to thank Randy, I think the two students here tonight, Randy and Charlene. Charlotte, well, thank you so much. I'm going to steal some of your stuff. You know, I don't know if I'm tough-minded, tender-hearted. I can play with that a lot. I'm going to spend some time with that. So I want to thank you. And no one can take away your courage but you. No one can give you courage but you. I can play with that one too. So I thank you all so much. I spent quite a bit of time this afternoon with some of the students. I came away from that experience really renewed. And I want to say just a couple of things to them and the other young people here before I get into the crux of what I want to talk about this evening. You heard Barbara present, introduce, whatever it was, with all of these successes that she has helped me to attain. Well, I want to say to the young people here, I first ran for office in 1970. At 10 o'clock in the evening, I was declared a winner. At 3 o'clock the next morning, my doorbell rang, and I was told to get down to the courthouse because something had gone wrong. And I went down to the courthouse, and of course, they told me that when they were adding up the votes, somebody forgot to carry a one. So rather than being a 500-vote winner, I was a 500-vote loser. That was a tough way to lose an election. So the next morning, I got to my office. I was asked by a reporter what happened. And I said to the reporter, it looks like I didn't get enough votes. And she pressed me. Come on, Clyburn, you know what everybody's saying. What do you think really happened? I says, I really didn't get enough votes. That's not what I was thinking. That's not what I was feeling. But I learned from my dad, who taught me that you don't always say what's on your mind. So I want to say to the young people, things will get tough. I lost that election, but because I would not take the bait, 2 days later, a phone call came from the governor of South Carolina saying, come and join my staff. And the rest is history. if I had said what was really on my mind, the headline would have been different. And my life would have been different. So young people, don't always say what's on your mind. Keep some of your thoughts to yourself. Now, I ran again in 1978, ran statewide for Secretary of State. I got 48% of the vote, because you got to have 50%. I ran again in 1986, statewide. And again, I got 48% of the vote. And a friend of mine said to me after that election, "What are you going to do now? You know what they say, you have just run the third time, you have just lost the third time, and you know what they say, three strikes and you out." I said to my friend, "That's a baseball rule." And nobody should live their lives by baseball rules. So let me say to you, young people, even when you lose, you keep trying. If I had listened to that friend of mine and had given up after taking my third try, I never would have become the third in command in the United States House of Representatives, which is what I was when I was the majority whip. So I want to say to the young people, you stay in the game. Get courage. Hold on to it. Develop strength and determination. Nobody can take those away from you. And things are going to be all right. But I want to share with you a little bit of Martin Luther King Jr. I first met Martin I was 19 years old on the campus of Morehouse College. He came to counsel with us who were members of SNCC, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and there was some friction had developed between us youngsters and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, which he chaired. And so he came to meet with us, and we were gathered at a meeting at 10 o'clock in the evening after our workshops were over. The meeting was supposed to last for an hour. It was 4 a.m. The next morning, we walked out of the room. And I walked out of that room a changed person. I have never been the same. And I started reading and studying everything I could about Dr. King. I read all of his books. And I'm very pleased that you have taken on the title of his last book as the subject for your celebration here this evening. Where do we go from here? Chaos or community? Now, that book was written in 1967, a year before he was assassinated. The last time I saw him alive was July 31st, 1967. We were in the home of Septimus Ponsett Clark. Some of you may know her or remember her. And we had lunch together just before he was to address a mass meeting in Charleston, which turned out to be his last trip there. But what I want to talk to you tonight about something I think, not about the book, but about his letter. Now, I think
Those of you who have never read King's letter from the Birmingham City Jail, please read it. And if you have read it, read it again. I have read that letter at least 100 times. Read it already this year. I usually read it in preparation for King's holiday. Now, some of you may remember what was happening in the country at the time King got his letter. Now, that letter was written in 1963. After King had gone to Birmingham, Alabama, to challenge the laws there, the laws that kept its citizens of color in a second-class existence. King was arrested for his activities. And while he was sitting in jail, he got a letter from 8 white clergymen, one of whom, Reverend Hardin, who later became a bishop in the United Methodist Church, was from South Carolina. They said to Dr. King in his letter, and I'm summing it up here today for the purpose of this lecture, they said, "Now, Dr. King, we understand and we believe in your cause. We just think that your timing is wrong." Now, Dr. King sat down to respond to their letter. Many of you who have read the history of you know that they would not give him any paper to write on. He started writing that letter in the margins of his newspapers. And in that letter, he dealt with that whole notion of time. King, in responding to his brothers, he said to them, "There's something mysterious about how we look upon time. You all know it. You know what people say, just leave it alone, give it time. Things will be all right. Time is a great healer." King wrote, "Time is neutral. Time is never right, and time is never wrong. Time can only be what we make it." And then he went on to say that he was coming to the conclusion that the people of ill will in our society make a much better use of time than the people of goodwill. Turn on your television. Pick up your newspapers. And as you're riding along in your automobiles, turn the radio on and listen. And you will hear it, you will see it, and you can see how effective the people of ill will are in the use of their time. Truth means nothing. Facts don't get in their way. They just make good use of spreading untruths. When I was growing up, most people were taught that you couldn't use four-letter words. There was one three-letter word that we couldn't use. So when somebody called them, so you didn't grow up the way I did. So untruths, they don't let the facts confuse them. They make them up. And they talk about alternatives to facts. Ain't no such thing. So we should not buy into that. Because King, in concluding that particular part of his letter, he says, "We are going to be made to repent in this generation, not just for the vitriolic words and deeds of bad people, but for the appalling silence of good people. People of goodwill have got to break their silence. People of goodwill, we cannot sit back and wait on time to do it. We've got to fill that time. These preachers over here, I thought I was going to be one of y'all. When I was growing up, I thought I was going to follow my father into the ministry. We talked about it a lot. And I went off to South Carolina State with the full intentions of spending 4 years on that campus and then going to seminary. But I always was told that you had to have a calling. And I kept listening. I never heard the call. You know, I'm not saying I was not called. I just didn't hear. And so when I went home to tell my dad that I had changed my mind and I didn't think I was going to go to the seminary, he said to me on that day, I thought he would be disappointed. And he probably was, but he didn't show it. He simply said to me, "Son, I suspect the world would much rather see a sermon than to hear one." And I took that as my mantra. And I try every day, I step off that plane in Washington and hook up with Barbara Lee and the others. I try to make sure that everybody see in my work and my actions a good, productive sermon. Now, one thing we learn, those of us who grew up in this thing we call religion, there are a lot of false prophets. So I want to share with you, so I can get every word right, I want to read to you something. We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. That's the preamble to our Constitution. That's our mission statement. There's nothing in the preamble to the Constitution that tells us that this is going to be easy. It tells us what our mission has got to be. We cannot give up on the mission just because it gets tough. If it gets tough, the tough gets going. We can't give up. Nobody is going to take our courage away. And we know how to have tender hearts and know how to be tough-minded. Now, if you listen to the false prophets, they will tell you, and I know you all have heard this, they will tell you about how the great society failed in its mission. Now, we're getting ready to commemorate on April 4th, the 50th anniversary of the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. Now, King wrote the book that gives you the theme for this conference 2 years after the Great Society programs were established. The Great Society programs, the speech by Lyndon Johnson was 1965. And if you recall, I'm going to share with you all some things. When Lyndon Johnson gave his speech, He went out not to just to give a flowery speech like we hear today, but he followed his speech up with some programmatic advances. What happened after that speech? Well, on April the 11th, 1965, remember Bloody Sunday? On April 11, 1965, Johnson signed into law the Elementary Secondary Education Act. From 1965 to this day, you've heard it called many things. No Child Left Behind. But it's always been the Elementary Secondary Education Act. It's still with us today. A monument to the Great Society program. So when they get up and say the program's failed, you ask them about the Elementary Secondary Education Act. Well, on May 18th, Lyndon Johnson launched Head Start. Last time I checked, Head Start's still with us. A Great Society program that's still with us. On July the 30th, 1965, Lyndon Johnson signed legislation creating, of all things, Medicare and Medicaid, a Great Society program, and they're both with us today. Medicare did not fail, and Medicaid is not failing in spite of what they're trying to say. They are still with us. LBJ signed the Voting Rights Act, August 1968. Today, people are saying the Great Society failed on October the 2nd, 1965. Lyndon Johnson signed into law the Water Quality Act, still with us today. October 3rd, 1965, he signed the Immigration and Naturalization Act, got rid of quotas, giving rise to dreamers, still with us today. October the 30th, same year, Lyndon Baines Johnson signed the Motor Vehicle Pollution Control Act to get cars to clean up the exhaustion. Y'all here in California took it to another level. November the 8th, he signed the Higher Education Act for the first time, putting the federal government into helping young people achieve higher education. All of these programs that I just mentioned are still on the books today, and they will tell you that it failed. Now, our job today is to be just as creative and innovative as our forebears were in 1965. Barbara Lee and I have been working on creative, innovative ways to attack these problems. One of them we call 10, 20, 30. It's simply a program, and we were putting together the Recovery Act that we fought to get into the Recovery Act. It worked famously. All it says is if the census say that if you, your community, 20% of your community live in the poverty level and been there for 30 years, we're simply saying at least 10% of all this money ought to go into those communities. 10% of the money go where 20% of the people living beneath the poverty level for 30 years, 10, 20, 30. They put it in, and it worked famously. I often tell the story of a phone call I got asking me to come to a little place called Britain's Neck. Now, I know some of y'all from South Carolina. If you're from Marin County, then you know Britain's Neck is a little place in Marin County. The gentleman said he wanted me to come over on a Friday morning to dedicate, they were going to have a groundbreaking for this water system.
Well, I had already made some plans for that Friday morning. The golf course down at Hilton Head. And so I said to him, I said, well, look, why don't you invite me to the dedication? Because I got a little something to do on Friday. Why is it so important for me to come to a groundbreaking of a water system? He said, well, I just thought because we've been trying to get this water system for over 40 years. And the way we got it is because that little 10, 20, 30 you put in that law. I said, I'll be there. Nobody's going to get credit for this but me. 4,600 projects across the country got funded under 10, 20, 30. Now my Republican friends in the Congress are now trying to take it. Barbara Lee is on the Appropriations Committee. So I've been sitting down with Barbara. Barbara has now gotten them to put that in 12 parts of the appropriations bill. If that's what... Not a press conference. Just getting the work done. Just getting the work done. No, I don't know. Y'all don't have co-ops here. This part of California. But they got them in some parts of California. Rural electric co-ops. But I found something, I was working with people in rural communities. And what we found out several years ago was that people's utility bills had begun to skyrocket. They were paying $800 and $900 a month in electric bills. And we says, what's causing this? Well, these people had bought these manufactured homes. And all of a sudden, these manufactured homes had begun to wear out. Insulation going bad. Roofs leaking. They were heating and cooling the trees and the flowers on the outside. And the bills was skyrocketing. So we came up with a little program that's now in the law. It took me 8 years to get in the federal law. It simply says, if you are a member of a co-op, let's have an audit done on your house. And if the audit tells you that your utility bill is going up because you don't have good insulation, you don't have a good roof, you don't have a good HVAC system, let's rip all that stuff out, put in a new stuff, and let's see what we can do. Pay it back. Pay them loan back through your monthly bill. And guess what we found? People who have been paying $800 and $900 a month, their electric bill went down to $250, $300 a month. They were able to pay it back through their monthly bill. Total thing, two-thirds of what it's been costing them before. I went up to a young lady who was one of the first ones. I said, ma'am, tell me, what did you do with that extra money that you were paying the heat, the outdoors? She said, I was able to buy my child's school supplies for the first time. That's how you change lives. That's how you build pride. That's why we got to stay engaged. We can't let these people take over this country. We can't let greed take over need. Our country is our country when we work together. So I want to say to you tonight, as I want to read you the last paragraph of this thing I had written here, that I was going to say to y'all. As LBJ's Great Society program began to take root in 1967, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. wrote a book entitled, Where Do We Grow From Here? Chaos or Community? I believe we stand at a similar crossroads today. There are forces
that seem to desire chaos. They thrive on it and in it. But America's promise and the search for a more perfect union rest with the community. That, after all, is the real entitlement and responsibility of every American. Thank you and Godspeed.
Come on, let's give it to him. Congressman James Clyburn. Congresswoman Barbara Lee. Elihu Harris. This has been an incredible night. You have been an incredible audience. We thank you for being here. We thank Merritt College. We just thank everyone who was a part of this evening. And as we leave, I want to leave you with one thing. Mark your calendars, March 10th. The Barbara Lee Elihu Harris Lecture Series will feature Anita Hill, one of the most controversial and famous figures in American history. Ask Clarence Thomas. March 10th. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Have a wonderful evening.